Hi, so I'm Vishal. I work with the data science team at Freshworks. And I work as a part of a specific product called Fresh Sales. So Fresh Sales is basically a sales CRM. And it kind of helps you prioritize leads, pursue leads, interact with leads, and sort of communicate with them better, and even so you can sort of organize and sell to these leads. Now, if you use the sales product, you realize that one of the problems with such products is that you might often have too many leads. These leads might be coming from different sources, and you may not have enough agents to handle these leads. So one AI feature that we decided to build was called lead scoring, which sort of helps you prioritize leads that are most likely to close. Now, the lead scoring algorithm is kind of trained on all the deals that you've closed in the past and the deals that you've lost. So we wanted to score these leads. Now, while training this model, one insight that we got was that the number of emails that you receive from the customer and the interactions that you have with him are one of the strongest features. And in a lot of cases, we noticed that in deals where you were receiving more emails from the customer, it was more likely that the deal would close. But one problem with this was we weren't looking at the content of the conversation. The content of the conversation was providing a lot more insight to us that could predict the probability of the deal closing. So we decided to go at it in a conventional sentiment analysis perspective. But the problem with this, again, is that most emails that are found in sales conversations are quite polite. They are rarely abusive, and you really can't use conventional sentiment analysis algorithms where people are either too happy, too sad. And so most sentiment analysis algorithms that work on tweets don't work on sales emails. So we decided to take it from a different perspective, and there are a couple of challenges that we had while doing this. So first, I'll talk about data cleaning itself. Now, if you've ever done tweet sentiment analysis, which is a very cliched project to do when you're in your undergrad, you would have noticed that a lot of the data that you get is clean text, whereas emails are often found in HTML. So the first problem that we had to come across was to clean the HTML text to sort of get rid of all the junk tags, the tags that aren't required. Now, even once we had the clean content, we had to get rid of the signatures. We had to use, for that, we used entity recognition. But the bigger problem that we had was a target label. We had about 20 emails in a single lead, and we didn't know which label to consider. The label that was quite obvious to start with was, hey, did the lead eventually close or not? Was it won or was it lost? But the problem was the label kind of applies to all emails in the lead. So right from the first email where somebody says, hi, I'm Tom, to the last email where the person says, I would like to go ahead with the most basic plan you have, all emails kind of have the same label, which is not true because not all emails are equally indicative of winning or closing. And a majority of the mails that we actually find in sales conversations are neutral, where people are pretty much just acknowledging what the agent said. So this is where we decided that we initially didn't get pretty high AUC. So our next alternative was to perhaps use only the mails that show up towards the end of the deal closing, because these are sort of more substantial. These are more final of sorts. These are more indicative of what the person is going to go with in the end. This did lead to a slightly higher AUC, but again, it wasn't significant enough. So we had to manually tag these, and what we realized was that a majority of these emails are actually neutral. The last problem that we had was to embed the emails again. So once we had sort of parsed the emails, cleaned them up, and we had the target labels ready, we had to figure out the best way to encode them. So we initially went with FastText and Word2Vec models, but to combine the word embeddings to an email embedding of sorts was one challenge. So what we tried was we also wanted to take some learnings from TF-IDF, where we prioritize rarer terms while also not giving much importance to the terms that occur frequently. So we use a form of polarized Word2Vec where we kind of multiply the polarity of different words into their word vectors and then use a classification algorithm on them. And once we even had an email level and an email level embedding, we had this is the last thing that I wanted to talk about was having context, because an emails are often part of a dialogue. So if we're looking at an agent customer email, we also have to look at the agent mail preceding that. So instead of scoring individual agent mails, we're scoring agent and customer mails together. So,
yeah. Okay. Yeah. Finally, thank you so much. Questions for Vishal? Questions? Okay, Vishal, so why did you try to take this as a problem in which you are doing, like, there is a sequence in the emails, right? So you didn't think of a question-answer kind of sequence and try and address it as that model as opposed to just a single classification model, if I picked that correctly?
No, but it's not just a question-answer model. It's also a question-answer-answer-question model, because the customer also asks a lot of questions which the agent needs to address, because the customer might not be sure about how a certain feature works or how to get something done.
So right.
It's not a one-to-one-to sort of situation where we can just consider them to be. They are a sequence, though. So we sort of generate conversations for all the, we take all the agent mails in a row, all the customer mails in a row, generate predictions on all of them. We call that a dialogue.
And so you label each element of the dialogue, or you label the whole
dialogue,
stream of dialogue, what it ended?
We label each dialogue, and then each stream of dialogues, we get a prediction from them.
Okay, interesting. That's a lot of labeling to try and do that. We have one question at the back, I understand. Yeah, go ahead, ma'am.
So what were some of the interesting patterns that you observed during the training? Like, for example, you said that you started using only the end emails, but how did that really help? Because you would like to know whether a deal is going to close or not when you start, like, in the first few emails itself.
So in the first few emails, the customer is curious. The customer is curious to try a product. The customer hasn't made up his mind yet. However, towards the end of the deal stage, the customer has a better understanding of what he wants to buy, or if he's really going to go ahead with that. So that really helps us, because towards the end, the customer might make definitive statements like, oh, I was looking for this feature, but this isn't present, or I will be going ahead with this. So because the emails towards the end are more definitive, we noticed that take training just on those gave higher AOC.
Okay. Huge round of applause to Vishal for his, I think there is some insight in trying to think about the buying process or awareness, insight, decision, action, and trying to see how that you can get from that email conversation, but it's a great attempt, and continue the conversation outside and you'll get more ideas.